Hi, I am Maximiliano Firtman, a mobile web developer. The Go language is powerful, fast, and easy to learn. In this course, we are going to start with the fundamentals of the language. Then, we will build simple, secure, and scalable APIs for your websites and apps. As a web developer, this is the fastest way to get you up and running with Go.
So, for example, if I want to create a variable for this text, we use var, the message, the identifier, and the type. In this case, it's a string, lowercase s. You will see that the Go's compiler, so the mix between the compiler and the linter, so both are working together here, they have anxiety. They suffer from anxiety. So you will see a lot of error messages immediately after creating a variable. And that's because you haven't used the variable. Okay, and at one point, it will stop your flow of thoughts at first. Because they say, come on, what's going on? I have an error. Well, you didn't use the variable. Yes, I have just typed it. It's like, give me a break. Okay, but you will see that a lot. Okay, it's really a common pattern when you start working with Go that you feel that kind of weird. It's like, give me a break. I have just created the variable. I know I didn't use the variable. So that's why when you're still thinking what you're going to do, if you want to get rid quickly of that error message, most of the time you have at the end of the function a print that you will delete later, where you just print all your variables. So because you are using the variable, now the linter is not complaining anymore. Of course, you can disable the linter as well, but that's not a good idea, okay? Because we want to keep it. In this case, I can create a number, a price. Okay, the same. It's complaining. Why it's complaining? Because I'm not using it. And by the way, print accepts a dynamic amount of variables, so I can actually use comma and send more than one variable at the same time. I can reuse the same print and print many things. So what is the value for the message? In this case, it will be an empty string. It's going to be nil, so it's an empty string, actually. Of course, I can set a value by default, like hello from Go. And if you run this, you see hello from Go, and blah, 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 blah. But that's actually a float. We will see how to format that later. We'll talk about data types in a minute as well. But you can see that on price, I didn't set the type. Can I? Yes, I can. Just spoiler, it's float 32, for example, 64. But I don't need to set the type if I have an equals in the same line, the same here as a string, because it will implicitly get the type from the value, from the literal value that I'm using here. Okay, so for those of you that were kind of afraid of data types, well, you don't actually need to explicitly set the type all the time. Sometimes, yeah, it will be necessary, but sometimes it won't. And in this case, I might not need the bar. I can use directly colon equals, the shortcut. But what's the difference? It's just creating the variable for you. That's all. And you use that a lot. In Go, we use that a lot. So you don't need to set the variable, because when you set the variable, it first creates a variable with zero, with nil. And then later you set the value. In this case, you create the variable and set its initial content in the same line. And for that, we use the shortcut. Okay, that's all. And for constants, you cannot use the shortcut, so you must use the const. So then you say, I don't know, pi, something like that. If you want, you can set the data type or not. An interface, it's a definition of methods. It's a list of methods. And we can use polymorphism, or at least emulate polymorphism with this. Let's see them in action and how it can help here. So for example, we can say that, let's say you can, I'm going to add some, it's not necessary to add this method for you to get a better idea. I'm going to add a method on the course that, so it's a method, so it has this special thing that will, for example, sign up. You can ask for sign up. It will return on a bool, whatever, and it will return true. Yeah, you are in. Okay, so sign up to the course. So, and of course, the workshop can have the same as well, and also it can have its own sign up. But if I try to do that, it says, hey, well, this is course, so you shouldn't change this. It doesn't matter the file, where it is, it's in the same package, okay? So I can change the implementation here. So both course and workshops, they have sign up, okay? Make sense? So now I can go to the same package. Typically, we create a new file for this. I'm going to create an interface. First, it's a new file. We start always with package and the name of the package. And then we create a new type that we can call it signable or kind of course, kind of sign up. Any name will work. You will understand the name in a minute, like signable, something that you can sign to. And it's an interface. And what do you put here in the interface? A list of methods without any code, just the signature of the method. In our case, it's going to be signup bool. So I can say I wanted to have a function with the name signup bool. Okay, something like this. I still need to work with this, okay? So let me show you the idea here, how it looks like. Because you can see that it's complaining because I have one more step that the fun keyword is not necessary here. So an interface is just a list of methods. And then we can use that as a type. You say, OK, if you have ever played with Java, C#, PHP, Swift, Kotlin, they have interfaces or protocols. It's kind of something similar. I really like the name protocol. It's not the Go name, but I like the name to understand what's going on. So we are defining a protocol. And then we can see which structures are following the protocol, are implementing the interface. So in this case, I don't need the fun keyword. That was the thing. So it's just the same function declaration without the fun keyword. Okay? Just that. So now I can go to my array and say, you know what? It's not going to be array of course. Because if I say so, it will be only instances of that structure. Okay? I'm going to say they're going to be signables or signables. And now it works. I don't have any errors. And I'm seeing your faces, even I'm imagining the faces over the camera. Like, wait a minute. Where did I set that a course and a workshop are implementing that interface? I'm not saying it anywhere. In Go, it's implicit by the name or the signature of your interface. So if you have a type, any type with that method, with that signature, you're in. You're in the interface automatically. You don't need to say so. You don't need to say implement signable. No. It just works. Any type with a method sign up, returning a bool, will be in automatically. That's what is known as, do I say here, implicit implementation. So let's run this because I didn't run this yet. And now it works. Both are working properly because both are having that method. So I can create an array, a collection of them. That's an interface. So, and that's polymorphism, like looping through a lot of objects without actually knowing the kind of object. I just need to know that it has the function or the action that I need. It's time to see how to work with web services. So if you want to create a little API that can serve our exhibitions, okay, as an API. We are still staying with vanilla Go, so no libraries. Okay, then I will show you some libraries that are available to do this faster if you want. I don't know. But anyway, with Go, it's pretty straightforward. So we are going to create for that a package. So I'm going to create a new folder. Let's call that folder API. And within the API, we are going to make two RESTful operations, a GET and a POST. And of course, then you can add the rest. It's pretty straightforward. So we're going to, I can separate this by verb if you want to, like all the GET operations in a GET.go and all the POST operations in the POST.go. So we will make a code that, so we can add a new exhibition, for example. Okay? Remember, you can connect this to a database or to any data source if you want, just using a library and understanding how to use SQLite or SQL Server or MongoDB or so on. So what are we going to see here? We're going to create here is, for example, a function to get one or more exhibitions. In fact, we can read the query string, and if we receive an ID or an index, we are going to return one. And if we don't receive that argument, we will return all the exhibitions. The exhibitions that we have here. OK? Yeah, it's a very simple, static, hard-coded database. Okay? That's not a good idea. Don't do that at home. But so we are going to then create a GET that will have the writer. It's always the same thing, response writer. And then http.request. That's the signature of every handler. Let's start first serving all of them. So what I need is to send to the output JSON. Okay, and remember that we've seen Marshall and Marshall, so we could convert the JSON to a string and blah, blah, blah. But fortunately, we have something much simpler. There is a way in the JSON package to create a new encoder. And the encoder receives as an argument a writer. Who is the writer? The argument that we are receiving in the handler. So in this case, instead of receiving a string and using our Marshall and Marshall to work with the strings, we can just send directly the stream of JSON to the output. That is even faster. I don't even need to create a temporary string in memory. So basically, in this case, while the encoder is taking out my object and creating the string for the JSON, we are sending the bytes to the network directly. We go to the stream. And we ask that encoder to encode one particular object. Which object? The one that we have in data, get all. Pretty simple. Do we need something else? No. The only thing that if you want to be a good citizen for APIs, the only thing that you need to add is a header to specify that you are sending JSON. Because by default, HTTP understands that you are sending text. Some APIs will never care about that header, but maybe it's a good idea to add a header. And to add a header, we also talk to the writer, and we say header. It's a function that returns an object value with some functions, for example, set. We can set a header. I'm not sure if you are experienced with HTTP headers, but the header is content type, and the value that we need to send is the type. That for JSON is typically application JSON. That's a handler. And to test the handler, I need to register the handler in my server. So we need to go to the main and register this handler. So I will go to main.go. I will put it here, so you can still see my get there for a while. So I will add server handle func. I can say /API/exhibitions. We'll go to API, because it's a different package, dot get. So when that API is hit, we are executing the get function from the API package. I need to restart my server because I have changed Go code. And let's try this. I will go to API/exhibitions. And now I got a nice JSON back as a result.